Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I've got an amazing edition for you today. I can already feel it. It's not even been recorded yet, but I can already feel it's going to be amazing. I am joined by... Right, let's do this. I'm nervous now because there's so many. We're joined by Emily Two Belts, the UCW Women's Champion, two-time W3L Women's Champion. I'm joined by the best, the beautiful, the only, Advicebeech, Podcastbeech, Wrestlebeech, Tweetchbeech, Toasties, Best, BFF, and ADM's Bestie for Life, Emily Hayden. And the creator of Emily's Army. Welcome.
Oh, thank you.
Did I miss any?
Well, I don't think you
out. and one half of the Wrestle Pals. There we go.
Oh, there we go. Carp would have killed me if I forgot that one.
I know, and I mixed out one half of Pixel Bitches as well. So I've got there. I almost got there. Yay. Anyway, we'll speak about all that later. But first off...
What? I said you got it all. Like, that was awesome. Like, sometimes I forget half of them as well, you know.
Again, I'll probably end up going to you here going, Networkbeech. We've got Networkbeech in there as well. I don't know if that's a new one you're adding in the future. Anyway, right, boring question out of the way, and then we'll have some fun, hopefully. How did you get into pro wrestling?
Well, just pretty standard answer. I grew up watching it with my dad and my brother. I was a bit of a tomboy growing up, if you couldn't guess. So from about the age of four onwards was when I started watching it. And so you can thank my dad and my brother for getting me into wrestling.
And who was the first wrestlers that caught your eye?
So the first wrestlers that caught my eye, I've talked about this time and time again, Chris Jericho. In particular, his debut on WWE with The Rock when he was having the back and forth, and that sucked me into like watching it because of the entertainment value. And I was like, wow, look at these two guys, like, listen to what they're saying back and forth. Another one I would need to say is Edge. Love Edge. I cried when he came back at the Rumble, and I cried when he won the Rumble as well. So happy. Another one, of course, I always need to mention, Eddie Guerrero. I love Eddie. And in terms of like females, of course, Lita, Trish Stratus, your standards, Victoria, Ivory, China. I could keep going on and on, but you know.
I'm sure you heard my very embarrassing running with Lita on Ella's podcast, a wrestling gal. Lita's absolutely one of my favorites. All the Hardys seem to pop up Team Extreme in general. I don't know if it's just because we're quite similar aged, but everyone round about my age, a couple of years either, are it seems to be the Hardys and Lita and all that. It's the cool ones, pretty much, kind of thing. And then you get your Stone Colds, Rocks,
100%. Because I remember when I first saw Lita, and it was the first time she'd done a moonsault off the top rope, and that's when I was like, oh my god, girls do this too? Because at this point, all I'd seen is men, so I was like, there's a girl, and she's doing a cool flip, and then that was kind of when I cemented it into my head about, okay, I want to be a wrestler now, because it was one of those things, as soon as I saw Lita do it, I was like, I need to do that too.
It's almost seamless into the next... kind of standard wrestling interview question. So what made you decide to go from watching Lita do the cool flips to going, right, I'm going to find a way to do it myself? Where did you start?
Oh my goodness. The first thing I always say is that I used to think growing up, because you know what it was like, because like you said, we've grew up around about the similar time. All you would see is like WWE and Sky One. So I thought, oh, you need to go to America if you want to be a wrestler. Had no idea about the British background and whatnot. And then I went to college back in 2012 and I was studying computing. And one of the guys in my class, he actually said, we were talking about the SummerSlam pay-per-view of that year. And one of the guys in the class overheard me and he said, oh, do you actually want to train to be a wrestler? And that way I'm kind of just looking at him like, yeah, why? What's going on here? And then he said to me, there's a training school at the Airdrie Leisure Centre, if you'd be interested. And that way I did not believe him at first. I thought he was ribbing me because I'm a girl that likes wrestling. So I was giving it, no way, that's not a thing. So then we went back into the computing class. He showed me it all on the computer, like photos from shows and such, like the famous David Wilson's photos. And I took his word for it. I said, awesome. Give me the name of the school, give me the name of the trainer. And literally a week later, I attended my first day at the Airdrie Leisure Centre. I forgot what it was called there because they've moved. My goodness. But yeah, I went to the Airdrie Leisure Centre and I did my first day with TJ Ridge.
So before you even started your training then, you weren't that aware of wrestling in the UK or even Scotland in general? You hadn't been to any tribute shows or anything like that beforehand?
No, I'd never been to anything like that before, but I know. I always hear about the fake Undertaker and all that. And I'm like, why didn't I see this? This sounds amazing.
I've said it in previous podcasts, I got the fake Mankind is what I got. So it was a fat lad in a shirt and joggers and a sock on his hand. That was pretty much what I got. But it's the first time my dad took me to a show, and he took me to it, and afterwards went, well, we're not doing that again, because it was so bad. I was 11, and he didn't take me to a show again until I was like 16, and that was only because it was my birthday. But it was just like, oh, nah, they going again. It was just so bad. Thankfully, we're in a better age for wrestling. I mean, it wavered a little bit last year, of course, and there's no shows. Yep. General, the talent core is better. We're not seeing fake Mankinds. Although I think that should be the first show when everything comes back and open. Just do a tribute show to kick off everything. Great fun.
Oh, I would love that. I would totally dress up as like, I don't know, Sting or something. Like just something that you actually do, like makeup.
which one would you pick? Sting. What? Yeah, the hair, black hair, all done already. So sorry. Would you go? Like TNA Sting with the t-shirt, or would you go for full Scorpion everywhere kind of Sting?
Oh no, I think I would need to go full Scorpion. I would need to commit to it, you know, because like Sting's another one that I grew up watching. I remember when I saw him and he had the face paint and that, because I'd just seen the movie The Crow when I was like 8. Like I shouldn't have been allowed to, but and I remember just thinking that this guy was the Crow, so anytime I saw him on TV, but it's the crow.
It's weird, but my first introduction to Sting.
I do commit full Scorpion gimmick.
Yeah, my first proper introduction to Sting, because I was a WWF guy, because I never knew. WCW was the only outlet I had for it was Thunder. So, was it Thunder? Worldwide, sorry, Worldwide on Channel 5. So I wouldn't see much of all the big names, because it's Worldwide. You'd see, I don't know, Mortis, Glacier, all those kind of dudes. Filthy Animals. Remember Filthy Animals, though. And so, yeah, Sting for me is TNA. That's how I remember Sting as. So probably not peak Sting, but still. I love Joker Sting for anyone that's watching and listening to this. Oh, amazing. Right, okay, so you started. What were your first thoughts then? Because you've gone in thinking, right, this probably isn't real. This guy's giving me details. I'm going to try this. What were your first? Do you have a sports background beforehand? Were you quite ready for the cardio involved, or just what was your first thoughts on that first day?
Billy, first of all, I have no sports background. I was the girl that would stay home and play video games. That was me. I was a little weirdo. So no, absolutely no sports background whatsoever. So my first day at training was so daunting. Like I walked in. There was like all these guys. I was the only girl there. Like Kenny Williams was still training when I walked in my first day, because Krieger hadn't started at this point yet. He started not long after me. But yeah, so I looked around and I remember just doing this and going, oh, I'm the only girl here. here we go. And I was so shy. I was so scared to like even say anything. And then, because we would train in a ring, like it was all mats. So I was like, where's the ring? And then of course, that was when like TJ said to me, the ring's seen as a privilege when you're in that chance to train by attending shows and helping and whatnot. You'll get the chance to go in the ring then and train. I was like, cool. And then we done the warm up and I nearly died. And then I done my first bump and I nearly died.
Yeah, but well, I'm the same as you growing up then. I preferred video games and definitely not downloading anything illegal off LimeWire. That was pretty much my standard weekend of stuff. No sport. I played football. I didn't play football well, but I think it was just a way to get out of the house once a week. Even though it encroached, because the football training was on Fridays at 6, and then it lasted about 5:30 to whatever. But worldwide started at 7, so I needed to be home by 7. So I think the only cardio I got was running from the football park to my house to make sure I'd be there for worldwide to see I don't even remember what happened to the show. I just remember the big Batman kablams and splats, and it was amazing. Right, this isn't a WCW podcast, so I keep going back to there. Right, so for according to Cage Match, which is sometimes they get it wrong. Your debut was 2014.
Yes, that is correct.
Well, one up for the Germans. So what was it like going into your first match then? It was, did I write it down? I did write it down. It was debut, you were tagging with Stevie Xavier against Casey and Switch is what I've got.
Ah, see, that was my full debut on one of the shows, like my main debut. My first ever match was on the old training shows for like Friends and Family, and I tagged with JD Bravo against Lucy Cole and Switch, and that was my first ever match, and that was scary. I had a panic attack before I went out, so that's fun.
So you say you're a shy kid. God, I made myself sound old there. You're shy. So what was it like going out in front of a crowd and trying to get them involved? I mean, friends and family, I suppose, is a little bit easier than people you familiar faces, but what was it like going to that first match?
Well, honestly, I felt it was like 10 times worse because it's people that actually know you. So it's like you need to stand there in spandex with people that know you, you know? Being like, oh, look at her, like, rolling about with these other people. But yeah, it was quite scary, especially because my dad came to my debut. So I feel like extra pressure was on me because I was like, this is the man that got me into wrestling growing up. Like, I need to look good. Like, but no, my debut was terrible. Absolutely terrible. Like, I blanked at one point and forgot, like, one of the bits that was supposed to happen. And me and Lucy were looking at each other, like, deer's in headlights. So, and then Lucy burst her nose, like, off my head. And it was terrible. Like, I cringe, like, looking back on it now. But the reason I tell the story is just so that anyone who ever listens or watches or anything, so that they know, like, it does get better. You will get better. There is no harm in having a debut go wrong. These things happen.
Absolutely. I mean, Dave, your first match is, you're hoping it's going to be your worst one, because then it just gets better from that point.
Yeah.
That's the theory behind it anyway.
We're
not all Ronda Rousey and going to go out and have the best match ever in their first go. That just doesn't happen.
I wish I was Ronda Rousey though, but you know, real life unfortunately sucks. So,
working within the ring with Switch is a character that, well, of course, he moved away a couple of years back, but he was one of my odd favourites. Now you get your boys, ones that aren't like big names, but you're like, I want to keep an eye on that guy. Switch was one of those. Just I hate clowns, so I was just watching it. It creeped me out, but I was enthralled at the same time watching it. Definitely one of those characters that missed. So we know that was your debut match then. Complete disaster. Your first actual main show match in front of a crowd that don't know you was that tag match we mentioned with Casey and yep. Switch and Stevie Xavier. So is that better or is that easier for you that you're in front of a bit more like blank faces than people you know?
Honestly, I felt a lot better going into that match because I had like experienced people like Switch and Casey and Stevie looking after me, making sure I knew what I was doing. Casey, I cannot speak highly enough of her. I remember, I think she could see I was nervous and she said, do you want to go into the ring and just go over a couple of things? And I was like, yeah, sure. So we got changed and then we went in the ring and she was, any questions I had, she was answering them. Any bits that I wanted to go over, she was going over and over and over again until it was drilled into my brain. Same with Stevie. Stevie could tell I was really nervous, but same with Switch. Like honestly, I've got fond memories when I look back in that match because they all looked after me. We had fun. They gave me really good feedback as well, which I've carried on with me into later matches. And honestly, I would actually love to tag with Stevie again because it was that much fun. And I would love to go against Casey again at some point, especially with the level that she's at now compared to back then, because she's this whole other level now. And I really think that with my new experience on top of that since back then, like we could really mix it up and do something exciting. So yeah, honestly, I felt like that main roster debut went so much better than my actual debut, but anything's better than that actual debut, my goodness, honestly.
I was going through your, again, I'm blaming the Germans for this, I'm going through cage matches, I do most of my match research, but to see the names that you have been in the ring with, it's not bad, it's pretty good. We've got Casey, of course, you mentioned, Stevie Xavier, we've got Kaylee Ray, Aisha Raymond, of course, one of your closer friends, and Noam Dar also. So it must be like kind of just a bit mind-blowing that you've gone from being really shy and just going, oh, I don't know if I should be doing this, to being in the ring with these now big names. They're on the network, WWE Network, NXT UK. Is there any match that for you stands out that you've enjoyed particularly the most? Well, we'll speak about your fierce female stuff in a bit also, but is there any match out there that people should try and check out?
There's a few that I could rhyme off. First of all, just going back to like the names that you've mentioned, I've been so grateful to be in the ring with the likes of Kaylee and Stevie and Aisha and Noam. Like you say, it was pretty surreal going from the shy person to being able to go through matches with the likes of these big names, especially with how talented they are. Like they're scarily talented. In particular, I've got two matches that stick out for me. The one people should check out, and two because they hold like a special place in my heart. So the first one I'm going to have to say is the show that I did at the Airtown Hall, because that's my hometown, and it was the triple threat match that I did against Kaylee Ray and Angel Hayes. So that match was so special for me for so many reasons. First of all, because it was in my hometown, my friends and my family got to see me, especially with the more experience I had at that point as well. And then just for the fact as well that, of course, I was in with Kaylee, I was in with Angel, look how talented the pair of them are. And then that's three generations from the school, you know, that's three generations. So Kaylee was the first one, I was the second one, and then Angel's carrying the torch now. So it's special to me for that reason. And I remember I got lots a really positive feedback for that match, and a few of the boys backstage were saying how I've really improved with my ring work and whatnot, and that meant the world to me, because I always feel confident in terms of my character and promo work and whatnot, what I'm doing, but I was always very hesitant when it came to my ring work. So yeah, that meant the world to me. And then the second match, I need to name my sis, Aisha Raymond. It was Full Tilt Wrestling back in February of last year. And I've wrestled Aisha many, many times. I'm sure it says on Cage Match, like many, many times. But that one was special to me because before the world ended, Aisha and myself, we were going to Respect Pro Wrestling, and we were doing like private sessions in there, and the likes of DCT and Bobby Roberts and whatnot, they were actually helping us to improve our in-ring work and helping me come up with a new moveset, because I really wanted to elevate, because I feel like I'm at that point now where my ring work should really spot on, like that's the thing that I really need to work at, and I wanted to show people this whole other side to me. I didn't want it to just be, oh, she's a character and that's it. So I spent a lot of time at Respect with Aisha practicing for this match, and then as soon as we went to Full Tilt and did the match, everyone was saying to us, that's the best match we've ever seen you do, we have to get you and Aisha back again to do a match similar like that. And we're just getting a lot of praise for it. And because I know how hard myself and Aisha worked to make that match look good and to show that we can step up another level, that's one of the reasons why that one means so much to me. And because she's my sis, so.
The last couple of years, though, you've really went from, with embracing your character work as well, to your in-ring work. It's just been, like, incredible. I mean, first time I saw you wrestle live was at one of the Elgin shows, W3L Wrestling Showdown, where we actually had a very, very brief interview when I had a little recorder and just terrified, because I'd never spoken to wrestlers for a prolonged period and tried to sound professional. And now I'm, 30 interviews in here, 40 interviews in to this ridiculous podcast, but yeah, it was great. You were against Debbie Sharp, and it had a moment where I think Debbie had taken in, what was it, protein powder or something, and I think it ended up slapping out of her hand, and it just went everywhere. I think it was the same show Dean Ford cracked his skull open. It was a very hectic show.
Oh my goodness. I know exactly what you're talking about. It was on the show before, because this is when we were doing the Northern tour, and I believe it was at the show on the Saturday night that we did, someone called Debbie fat, and like she and I were just affronted by it, because one, don't body shame, not just women, just don't body shame anyone in general, don't body shame wrestlers, wrestling's already a vanity sport, so don't do that, like, we already look at ourselves under a microscope enough as it is. So, as a joke, because Debbie and I were going to a shop, and we saw, I think, what was it, like, because... Debbie came up with the idea to see if she could get like a tub of Slim Fast. And we went into the shop and we're like, okay, let's see if we can find a tub of Slim Fast or like a drink of Slim Fast or something. And we couldn't. So we got, I think it was like hot chocolate or something like that, because it was powdery. And we took the label off it. And then she put a label around it that said Slim Fast.
I remember that when you were speaking about it. I remember it was just written Slim Fast.
Slim Fast on it, and I thought that was the greatest thing ever. So, yeah, it was Slim Fast quotation marks that went all over the place. And that was how it came about. Someone called Debbie Fat, and we weren't happy about it. So we thought, let's get a ton of slim fast.
Don't get slim fast in the north. We don't need it. We've got too many mountains, too many hills to climb. Although I probably need it myself, to be honest. But life's too short to not eat cake. So I'm going to just keep doing it. So that was the first time I'd actually saw you wrestle, met yourself. I said very briefly, because if anyone goes onto our YouTube, they'll find two versions of this interview. There's the one without the tormentor and one with the tormentor on it. And I'll be honest, listen to the one without the tormentor, because I don't know what he said. And I just nodded and went, yeah, yep.
We all do that most of the time as well when it comes to the tormentor. We just, yeah. Cool.
I'm dreading the day that eventually we get a round table with the tormentor, Jamie Jones, Roderick Jones, and there's another one. Ugh, there's another one somewhere. I can't remember his name, but just together.
Because that name floats about quite a lot.
don't besmirch the name of the Bulgarian baker.
Oh, listen, I've got plenty of time for the Bulgarian baker. Like, he's one of my favourite people.
It is the baker. Actually, come to think of it, because a very similar sounded person tried to offer my brother a donut last time W3L were up here, and he was nay having it. And for those that are watching this and unaware, my brother's got autism and learn disabled, so we have no idea what he's going to react to if this happens. Just every year, it's been my birthday, so I've gotten the birthday bread, and that's how he fixated on it. And so I contacted them and went, like, it's my brother's birthday that week. Can you give him a bit of bread or something? And he just sniffed it and went, nah, me having it. Put it down and left it. Oh, it was so cringeworthy and so funny at the same time. So you've travelled a bit then. You started in Airdrie. I did those shows. W3L, you were there quite early on as well. Is there any... I'm going to sound like Scottish Wrestling Discussion are doing interviews at the moment and ask this question, I'm stealing it from them. Any road stories from your travels that you're willing to share that can legally be shared?
Here we go. I've got quite a few. Let's see, this is when I go like off of my head, like, which ones can I tell and which ones can't I? In particular, I always end up with really funny road stories when... Benny in particular, Big Benny and Bobby Roberts are involved. I think Benny's told practically everyone this story, and I would be doing him an injustice if I didn't tell you this one as well. So Benny and I were coming back from training at Respect, and basically, when he died, he took the wrong lane on the motorway. So there was a truck oncoming towards us. And Benny started freaking out. I started laughing so hard at him freaking out. Like, I was hysterically laughing. I had tears streaming down my cheeks. He started screaming at the van, who obviously couldn't hear us, going, please don't judge me too harshly for this. And then the car stalled again. And he shouted, not like this. And then... He managed to get the car to work, and we got, like, as we turned away, he started shouting, we have to go back, like, quote and lost. and then a panic and just say, he pulled up at a Tesco nearby and he bought himself Krispy Kreme donuts to cheer himself up. And that, my friends, is the story of how Benny almost killed me.
I've written down near-death car journey with Big Benny on my notes, so I could score that one off. if it makes Benny feel any better, I had an absolute nightmare in Aberdeen. I hate driving in Aberdeen, and it's a shame because WrestleZone are there, and that's where I go. And to calm myself down, I went to the local Smiths and looked at all the Funko Pops to calm myself down. Didn't buy any, but, you know, it was still... I was like, oh, they look nice. Anyway, right, other stories. Bobby Roberts, I'm sure, has got a few.
My goodness, I've got a few with Bobby. One, it was, I think the first time we all went down together to Full Tilt Wrestling, this is when I was wrestling Chantel Jordan on it. So that was my debut match, and it was myself, Bobby, Kiss, and Benny. And I think this is how Unity started. We were in the car and we're driving, and Bobby always makes like a wee playlist for us, like in the car when we're going. And there's one song in particular he'll always put on for us. And it's an Adam Sandler song. It's called At a Medium Pace. Listen, if you've not listened to the song, listen to it. It's hilarious. But we are all singing this song full pelt. And with tears streaming down our faces as we sing it. And the night before, because like sometimes if we've got a show, we all just stay at Bobby's. Like Bobby and his wife are like fantastic at where they always look after us. And so the night before, we were all camped out in the living room. It was like a big sleepover party. And Benny, Chris, Bobby, Ruby Roberts was there as well. She came over to hang out for a little bit. And we were all watching just silly stuff on YouTube. And we were watching clips from the Dave Chappelle show. And it was the one where he impersonates Prince and Rick James. And that's how Unity started, because of that Rick James episode. So we were just quoting all sorts. Like, we were in the car giving it, give it to me, baby. And shouting, Charlie Murphy, we were shouting that as well. And we actually worked it into our matches at one point. We would just randomly shout Charlie Murphy. So I've got many amazing stories of Bobby. I'm trying to think, so I've got another one. One I remember as well that involves Dean Ford is anytime that I go to Shield with him, Shield Pro Wrestling. Dean, I'm sure he's talked about it. He loves the Backstreet Boys. He loves his cheesy pop. So anytime me and him are in the car together going a road journey, the cheesy pop comes on. He and I are giving it our best Backstreet Boys life. So yeah, I had to give that a little mention to it. There's so many, but those are the ones that really stick out for me in particular.
The Dean Ford episode of ours just went out. I don't think I spoke to him about that. I'm really disappointed, because me and Grant McIver had a very long chat about terrible, terrible music that we both loved, including Backstreet Boys, Steps, Westlife. We had a very extended discussion about Westlife. I love that kind of crap pop. Give me crap pop any day.
100%.
To the point, I mean, it's not really pop, but one of my favourite songs that I've decided to annoy my wife with forever is Jimmy Nails' Ain't No Doubt. She had never heard this song before, and now I will not let her not hear the song whenever I can. So if she says anything, I'll just go, she's lying, and she goes, no, and other expletives that follow, because it's an amazing song. Terrible, but amazing. So Unity was another thing I had noted on here. We're cracking through these notes easily. So score that one out. Shield Wrestling, you've done some stuff in England as well, including becoming UCW Women's Champion. Again, anyone's listened to this before, we will be jumping back and forth the timeline. So we'll go down there first. What was your experience like down in UCW? And of course, you became champion, so all good. But how did you get involved with them?
I got involved through UCW when they were first starting out. I love the boys there. I love Darren. I love Ryan. They're promoters. They are wonderful people. The amount of laughs I always have whenever I see them. They've always been good to me. I believe I started, I did my first ever match with them back in like 2016. It was round about the time they were just getting in and whatnot, and Lucy Cole was the first ever women's champion, and it kind of just carried on from there. I believe it was, I hadn't wrestled for a while after that, and then come back at one point, and I got to work Gia, Gia Adams. She is a smashing girl. I love her, and the difference in her from that first time I've wrestled her, by the way, to like the recent time that I've wrestled her is unreal. Like, seriously, people need to keep their eyes on this girl. She is fantastic, but I digress. So I worked with Gia a couple of times, like when she was the women's champion, and then I believe it was Bobby, because he runs Respect Pro Wrestling. Bobby had like a working relationship with UCW, so it was like they wanted to do a trading talent sort of a show. So it was on one of the UCW shows, they had a couple of us from Respect on it, and then Bobby at Respect did a Scotland versus England show. So a couple of the UCW lads came and did that for us, and that was actually where I won the Women's Championships. I actually won it in Scottish grounds, even though it's an English belt. So I was quite proud of that one. I'm very fortunate where, I don't even know how to put it into words exactly. I'm just grateful that they decided that they wanted me to be champion after Gia, and honestly, I can't sing their praises enough. Like, they've been so good to me. Gia, I've got a lot of time for that girl. I keep talking about her, but I love her so much. And yeah, it was a very surreal moment when I won that belt. I actually cried as soon as the bell went and they announced me as the new UCW Women's Champion. I cried because it was just one of those things. It was a goal of mine to get one belt. So the fact that at this point I had two, it was such a lovely, overwhelming experience. And at that point as well, I got to say I'm a Scottish Women's Champion and an English Women's Champion. So yeah, honestly, I'm so grateful to them, and I love them so much, and I've got plenty of time for them.
That was actually my thought. I was trying, when you were speaking about getting the belt, and I was like, was that your first or second? So the first one would have been the W3L Women's Championship. Was it, I know it was Jayla Dark you beat for the second reign. Was it her you beat for the first one as well?
Yeah.
So she's one half of
It actually came like Maresoma.
Your Wrestlema, Jayla Dark, which I'm sure she appreciates.
She loves it. She loves it. Like, we'll randomly message each other, and sometimes our messages will start with me saying "Ma." Sometimes it'll be her going "Win." So.
but your second reign was, of course, was Jayla's last Scottish match, if I remember rightly, and it was a street fight or no hold barred or some description. And a street fight that didn't go on the streets, because I watched it because it's on YouTube. And again, it was one of those matches where I saw you way back in the Elgin shows, and then I got to see your character work over YouTube, and then I got to see this intense, like, baddie, because you were the good guy when I last saw you in Elgin, and now you're this badass with a kendo stick and battering Jayla Dark, who, I mean, batters most folk when she was wrestling. So what was it like finishing, well, having her last Scottish date and obviously lifting the W3L Women's Championship for the second time? Was there a lot of emotions in that match?
There was a lot of emotions in that match. Just to go back to like the first time that I won the belt, I always call, like, in my personal life, I always call this the infamous 2018, because this is just when everything in my personal life was going horrible. This is when my anxiety was at an all-time high, my depression was at an all-time high. So I put on weight, which, if anyone looks back at old photos of me, you can see, like, I think I put on, like, 30 stone. And then you look at me then, you look at me now, or you look at me, like, when I just debuted, it's, like, a totally different person. So when I first won that the WFL women's belt that time, I didn't cry, I didn't get emotional. I was kind of too much in my head about it the first time that I won, and I distinctly remember, I got my feet back off the jailer, and then I kind of went off and got myself changed and that, and in my head I was just going, you don't deserve this right now, you need to prove to everyone why you deserve to be W3L Women's Champion. You are going to take 2019 by storm. You are going to look like a champion. You are going to act like a champion. And honestly, I have to say, that's a very special belt to me, not just because it was my first, but because it was that moment when I won the belt the first time that I remember thinking, I need to get my act together. I need to do this. I need to do that. And it helped motivate me. So then you flash forward to when Jayla and myself did the street fight. Again, that was special to me for so many reasons. In particular, like you said, it was Jayla's last Scottish match. And it meant the world to me that she decided, because she could have went anywhere, she could have wrestled whoever, but she chose to make her last Scottish match with me for the W3L Women's Championship. And in particular, in her wheelhouse, a street fight. So I got my ma taking me through my first ever street fight, which was scary, but it was the most fun I've ever had. I would love to do another one. Even though she battered me with a lightsaber and a kendo stick and steel chairs and whatnot, I would do that again in a heartbeat. And the best introduction in the world, I got battered by my mum in a wrestling ring, you know? So I look back on the footage, funnily enough, from time to time, and I still get emotional when I watch it myself, because I remember the emotions going through my head. As soon as that bell went, and they gave me the belt, and they said, I knew W3L Women's Champion Emily Hayden, it hit me, first of all, oh my God, I'm a two-time W3L Women's Champion. I'm carrying on the legacy of the likes of Sarah, of Leah Owens, of Viper, of Nikki Storm, all these amazing names, and I get to carry on the legacy just like them, and of course Jayla. And then this other wave of emotion hit me, because I looked across the ring and there was Jayla, and she gave me the proudest smile ever. And I just took one look at her and I started crying. You can see me in the footage, I start crying. And we just looked at each other and I chucked the belt to the side and I gave her a big hug. And she was whispering in my ear at that point as well, I'm so proud of you, you have come such a long way. And that made me cry even more. So when I got backstage that time and I got changed and I was holding the belt for the second time, I remember going, you did it, Emily. You did everything that you said that you were going to do. Meant you lost the weight. You have put in the effort in the ring. You've done everything that you said that you wanted to do. And it made it even more special for that, because I got to share that with Jayla Dark.
I mean, for me, it's definitely a passing of the torch kind of moment, because from that point onwards, Jayla was one of those that she would be everywhere kind of thing. And now, since then, you've kind of filled that void where if there's going to be a women's match in a show, it's most likely it's going to be Emily Hayden battering someone in that match. So from that, we'll speak about Fierce Females then, because we can't not speak about Fierce Females, because this is kind of where I think the internet masses and everyone else kind of got to see your character side properly explode and just work at its full. It's just full madness. So it all started, what I've got here is your rivalry with Sammy Jo.
Yes, she is another very special lady in my life.
So it escalated to the point where you ended up in an I Do match, which, for those that are unaware, It's equivalent of an I Quit match. However, the only weapons that are allowed are wedding presents. Yeah, that there's more explanation needed.
Oh, so, and instead of saying I quit, you had to say I do as well. But yeah, it's basically an I Quit match.
What were your thoughts going into that match, and what was your input in that story into that conclusion of the I Do match?
it's quite funny to like kind of go behind the curtain with this now, because obviously everyone knows Emily Toasty, she's fired for Fierce Females, she's got a vendetta against Fierce Females, like everyone knows that. And I have to say, myself and Sammy Joe, we got a lot of input when it came to our rivalry, because it was I got an impromptu debut through Fierce Females, because I can't remember for the life of me the talent that couldn't make it, but Fierce Females put up a post just being like, if there's any wrestlers in Scotland that are available that day, if you can email. So I emailed over and I got the debut, and because I think I did like one or two matches with Sammy Joe before that, so they thought, let's put you in with someone that you're familiar with. I thought, great. Me and Sammy Joe ended up having that much of an intense match. People wanted to see it again. They wanted to see it again. They wanted to see it again. and we actually got to build a story towards it. So it was just amazing for me. It became like the final match was an I Do match, and it all started because I made a joke, because I believe it was the Fierce Females Dark show. The night before that was the Source show where Matt Daly proposed to Sammy Joe. So I made the joke, of course, and I got down on one knee and I said, Sammy Joe, will you marry me? And then I got up and I was like, just kidding, who would want to marry an ugly cow like you? And that's how the I Do match came about. And yeah, but Fierce Females were fantastic with us in the creative process, like throughout the entire feud, but in particular with the I Do match, because we would say to them, can we do this for a promo? And they'd be like, yeah, cool. And we're like, great. And they'd be like, can we have this weapon in the match? And they'd be like, yeah, cool. And then we'd be like, we need to take it one step further. Can we do this? And they're like, yeah. So they're just letting us do whatever. And it's one of the most intensely comedic matches ever. That was the birth of Toasty. Because Sammy Joe and myself were going like back and forth with ideas. And it came up in the conversation. What's the most common wedding present? A toaster. So that was how Toasty came about, and then it just kind of escalated from there. Like, I literally, like, Toasty only came into a promo because my friend used to help me film my promos before Jayla's husband would do my promos for me, and my friend, she wasn't feeling very well that day. She got fibromyalgia, so she was feeling horrible. And I thought, I'm going to make her laugh. So she went to the bathroom. And when she came back, I was sitting in bed with the toaster beside me, cuddling it. And she couldn't stop laughing. And I was like, right, film it. Like, if it's getting that reaction off of you, like, just put it up and see what everyone else says. And that's how Toasty came about. All because I just wanted to make my pal laugh, and all because me and Sammy Joe thought it'd be funny to have a toaster in the match.
I just want to correct you for a bit. You said that Emily Hayden's got a vendetta against Fierce Females. I think according to Twitter, I think it's the other way around, that for some reason refusing to bring you back, which has spawned hashtag Emily's Army to take over the crowd at Fierce Females events, including... Well, I mean, you made your return as well, which was disgracefully struck from the record. You were escorted out of the building when you answered an open challenge as well. So your work with Fierce Females is less physical, but more just, it's an amazing And not to like break the world of wrestling too much, but it's an amazing marketing tool. It's just incredible because you got you who's, I think you're the one that's plugged your own interview the most of all my guests so far. So you're very media savvy, social media savvy, and also you're very charismatic. So you do the videos, and all at the same time, Fierce Females is getting the advertising for it. It's just incredible to look out from the outside as a non wrestling fan, I suppose, just as a marketing kind of thing. That's boring. Let's speak about wrestling again. Right. So from there.
Thank you so much for saying that. I try so hard when it comes to social media. I see it as a privilege, like for the likes of yourself to ask me to come on to your show. So I'm like, well, the least I can do is plug your show. The least I can do for like a few females that will let me on their shows, I'll plug their shows. Like it's the least I can do because I'm just grateful for the opportunities, you know.
I think I nabbed all the questions I could find. I did have to do quite a extensive social media search to find where you put them. So I think I got them. But yeah, I think a lot of people forget that. I mean, if you're not advertising the show that you're going to be on, the people don't know that you're going to be on the show. I mean, Fierce Females, of course, notwithstanding, because you're technically not going to be on the show. But it's the case of, it's the least you can do is plug it. But that also spawned not just the Sammy Joe, not just Toasty, which if I remember my lore, my Toasty lore, it was a gift from Simon Casti and Sean McLaughlin.
Yes, it was. When I pulled the toaster out of the bag and it was revealed it was Toasty, I turned around to Sean and I said, "You shouldn't have, Sean." And Sean looked at me like I was talking daft, but I know it was from him. And all I heard from in the corner was Simon Casti going, "It's from the both of us." So yeah, he was a gift from Sean McLaughlin and Simon Casti. So you can thank them for Toasty being in your lives and making it all warm and toasty.
I like to imagine that they both went round curries the night before and just picked out especially for you. So Toasty became a character in itself. I don't know how to gender Toasty, so I'm going to go with them. So Toasty then became this big character, and Amy Alonzi ended up having them at some point. Again, your input in the I Do match, you had quite a lot of it. When Toasty blew up in the media world and on Twitter and what have you, it was just all ideas from that point for you going, right, how can we get Toasty everywhere?
Like, you know, promoters will actually ask me sometimes, "Are you bringing Toasty?" And I'll be like that. Like, you know, he comes with a fee, right? Like, he doesn't do his bookings for free. But yeah, literally, see, anytime yourself or any of Emily's army have seen Toasty, it is me going in my head, how can I make this funny? How can I make the fans laugh? How else can I escalate the fact that I'm friends with a toaster? How else can we escalate this? And I've always been like welcoming of ideas and whatnot. I believe it was Amy Alonzi herself. And Aspen Faith, they came up with the idea of putting the unicorn horn on Toasty at a Liverpool show. So that was kind of how it escalated from there, because just the banter between me and Amy on Twitter, and the feuds just escalated from that. So that came about accidentally, literally, again, just because of a case of what would be funny to do with Toasty, what will make people laugh. And that's that.
Of course, and that spawned Toasty getting a plaster because they headbutted Aisha Raymond by accident, of course. That whole like Fierce Female stuff is just incredible. The first like promo that sticks into my mind was you trying to get down to Liverpool and trying to figure out how to get a train using the old machine thing. And oh man, it's honestly you're the videos that yourself and the man formerly known as Sean Walker have made are just amazing. And if anyone needs to go check them out, they definitely should. But your stuff with Toasty, just one video, I can't remember what Toasty was watching, but it's when you walked into your living room and Toasty was watching, I don't know, I want to say something involving butter or toast, and you just slowly backed out.
He was watching a toaster pop out some toast. He was being a little naughty toaster and watching things that he shouldn't have. So that was my fault. I should have knocked first just to make sure he was decent, you know. But a lesson is learned now. I give the door a knock before I come into the room and ask him if he's decent, you know. So that was my fault.
So from that, I don't know how we're going to top Toasty Chat, but during lockdown, so before lockdown happened in about a year ago when this goes out, this will go out in, yeah, literally a year ago since stuff started, March 12th, this is due to go out. You did a chat with Kurt Johansson, who of course we will speak about in depth a little bit as well. And you spoke about your journey with mental health and stuff going on in wrestling. Then the world ended and the chat came out. And then the wrestling world imploded. So it's been a weird time. But you seem to go on the offensive for just getting your name out there. So you started the Advicebeech on W3L's YouTube channel and on your own. So again, was this just something that just you found funny, you wanted to do? What were your thoughts behind starting the Advicebeech?
So the idea came about because I think around about this time, W3L had already brought out the gaming stuff with Kev. So he would do like his top five games and whatnot, I believe. And then Mike Musso, he was doing, I think this was his workout videos that he was doing at this point in time, because I know he does another series about mixing cocktails. So there was like a lot of W3L content that was coming out at this point in time, and Mike contacted me and he asked like, oh, would you want to do any content for W3L? And I was like, yeah, sure, let me just try and think of something. And then me and Mike were kind of just going back and forth with conversations, and the topic of, remember like the old WWF magazines, and they would have like the articles, and you could actually ask Shawn Michaels and Sensational Sherry for advice and things like that. And I think there's one in particular, and it's Shawn Michaels and Alundra Blaze, and they're kind of just answering advice. So that came up, and I said to Mike, can I give people awful advice? And he said, yes, you can. So he go ahead and so Ask Advicebeech was literally, that was a joint effort between myself and Mike, like coming up with the idea. And then the rest of it was just hilarity on my part. Like, I would think like, oh, what would be funny to answer? And then I would ask my friends as well, like I would ask like Benny, Bobby, DCT, I asked like Rosie Knight, I asked my friend that used to film the promos as well, I asked Jayla, I asked the wrestler formerly known as Sean Walker, I just asked them all sorts of like, oh, what kind of a questions do you want to see me answer badly, and they would give me their questions. And a lot of the answers that we come up with, I have to say, like, I was inspired by like Always Sunny in Philadelphia and The Simpsons, with like the idea of all these terrible answers. That's where a lot of the inspiration behind the answers came from. Just, I watched a lot of TV during lockdown, you know. I still am. So, yeah, that literally just came about because I thought that would be funny.
And that moved on to the penultimate episode, which was the big bullying and mental health one. So this was around about the time where stuff is happening in the wrestling world that was just not good, but we're keeping this positive and light. But yeah, it was rubbish time. And your particular video, I mean, I made the excuse that I needed to put up the rest of your episodes because I wanted that one on my site that badly, just for people to see it. So again, what was your inspirations behind doing the bullying and mental health episode of Ask Advice Beach?
Wow. So I wanted to, while I had that platform for Ask Advice Beach, I thought, like, right, I've got a lot of eyes on this now, with obviously the comedy and the hilarity that I was doing in the episodes before. And I thought, well, I'm called Advice Beach, like, I should actually really touch on this subject while it's raw. And unfortunately, it was the passing of Hannah Kimura that really brought it on. And it was that resonated with me a lot, her passing, because it was bullying, cyberbullying. Clearly the girl was struggling mental health and whatnot, and I thought this is something that really needs to be touched on, like, in particular, like, I don't think people, not just fans, just people in general, I don't think they quite realise that wrestlers, like, as much as we appear to be superheroes when we're in the ring and we're doing this and that, at the end of the day, we're human, and I think people forget that, like, because we do these crazy things in the ring. And I just really wanted to talk about mental health because it's such a taboo subject, I feel. It's like, it's great that people are talking about it more and more now, but I feel like it needs to be talking, like, everyone needs to talk about it that much more, especially within the wrestling community, because I don't think people realise that it's like, everyone's entitled to have an opinion, but there's a fine line between an opinion and bullying. Like, I was bullied from a very young age, from primary school right up until high school. And my confidence was shattered because of that. That's where the shyness came from. To this day, I suffer from anxiety and depression, which I've touched on before. And I personally think I personally felt like that story, as I said before, resonated with me because it just reminded me of the struggles that I had. It reminded me of the struggles that I do still have. Going back to the time when I put on weight, obviously, again, the infamous 2018 when I was struggling personally. Professionally with wrestling, great. Personally, horrible. But round about that time, I was called fat off a couple of fans a few times, and when I was wrestling in the ring, they would shout, "You're fat, you're a fat kid," like, very, very condescending things like that. And I've talked about it as well. I struggled from an eating disorder before I started wrestling, and I always say it anytime I bring it up, wrestling saved my life. If it wasn't for me discovering that I could go and do wrestling, I wouldn't have gotten the strength to get my health back in check and actually go about the right way of losing weight and so on and so forth. So when I did the bullying and mental health video, it was coming from a raw place, from my own experiences, and I just wanted to highlight that this can happen to anyone. It does not matter if you're not involved in wrestling, if you are involved in wrestling, it happens to everyone, and it is something that we should talk about, and it is something that we should encourage people to do better and be kind about. So yeah, just while I had the platform, I thought now is the best time to do it, and that was how the video came about.
And it featured a lot of your friends and obviously other wrestlers as well, speaking about it. But yeah, on that subject, I mean, the defence from those kind of idiots will always be, free speech. But there's a line between free speech, but you're not free of consequence. So you can say whatever you want, yeah, But if someone punches you in the face for saying it, well, that's the consequence for it. So it's I've been to many shows where I'm not a very vocal fan. I don't like shouting. I just like to enjoy. I like watching. I like to escape. And I'm not like, I'll clap. That's about as far as I'll go. But I've seen shows where fans are just fans in the loosest possible sense of the word. Just absolutely give out about, especially women. It's like you got a free pass to shout whatever you want to them. And it's just gross to go to see. And I mean, I think the only acceptable chant that I find, which I'm personally offended by, but not enough, is a baldy chant. Baldy's allowed. That's fine. But if you're going to start going for like fat or anything like that, it's just, there's no place for it nowadays. And it's not PC gone mad or PC culture. It's just, there's just no need for it. It's just simple as that.
100%. Like I said, like, for all they knew, like, I could have still had my eating disorder back then when they were calling me fat. So, like, for all they knew, like, I could be going, like, back home and starving myself after that, you know? Thankfully, I didn't. Like I said, if it wasn't for wrestling, I wouldn't have overcame that struggle. But yeah, like, I don't mind, like, like you say, the silly name calling and stuff. Like, I don't mind, see, when like, you get the kids and they go, you're ugly and that. Don't mind that. I don't really care. I know I'm stunning, you know? Like, I'm Wrestlebeech, like, so. But just when it comes to body shaming, I'm not a big fan of that.
It's also, it's I think there's a statute of age as well. If it's a child, it's still not right, but if a child went fat, you're like, it's a child. Yeah. That's stuff they'll grow out of. If it's a 18-year-old with their first beer shouting it loudly, which unfortunately I have seen, which, God, there's also contextual, it's in the context of the thing as well. If it's a child, they'll learn that. A scowl out of you or a wee threat to batter them, that'll probably stop it quite quickly. But yeah, idiots that like their first beer and they've got a wicked and they're going to go shout fat at people. It's just... I don't know why that subject suddenly just ground my gears a lot, and I've just kind of went into a bit of a rant about it. But well, I said, we're keeping it light, we're keeping it positive. So before all that, though, like say, you spoke to Kurt Johansson, of course, a friend of our show. We've interviewed him for our Untitled series, and the term Wrestle Pals was born. So how did you get in touch with Kurt? Did Kurt get in touch with you, and how did that come about?
So Kurt got in contact with me, and it was through, again, my sis, Aisha Raymond, because Kurt did an interview with Aisha, and she brought me up at one point. So I believe because she brought me up, Kurt tagged me in the tweet, like plugging the interview. So I gave it a listen, and I was retweeting it, singing the praises and whatnot, and then next thing you know, I get a DM from Kurt on Twitter, and I'm like, stalker match? No, I'm kidding. So Kurt contacted me, and he was just like, hey, would you be interested in doing an interview as well? And I was like, yeah, sure, would love to. If Aisha's more than happy to do an interview with you, then you must be cool, you know? So we did the interview, and just before it, we were kind of chatting in general. And then from then until we actually recorded, the chemistry was just off the charts for Kurt and myself. It was like, it was, the banter was flowing, we were getting a laugh, we were having a lot of fun, and we bonded over a lot of interests that we both had. We're both a big fan of horror movies, we're both a big fan of comic books, video games, TV shows, pop culture, and it escalated from there, and the term wrestle pal came about because obviously I met him through wrestling, so we would always refer to each other jokingly like, ah, it's my wrestle pal. And then it was Kurt that actually came up with the idea, why don't we do a podcast? I feel like people would enjoy that. And I was like, listen, I had a great time talking to you, but I've got no interest in talking. No, I'm kidding. I was like, of course, like, I had a great time talking to you. And it was so much fun just talking about whatever. And then I was like, oh, imagine the madness that we could get on with, like, just talking about random things. So we're actually going to record the first episode soon. And because obviously Kurt, his daughter was born, so that kind of put a hole on when we were actually going to start. So, because he's a new daddy and all that, and time with your, especially a cute little baby like his daughter. And so we're going to record soon. And we're actually talking about one of the episodes that we want to do is about Marvel. And another one we're going to talk about is horror movies. And you can best believe we're going to be talking about video games at some point too. So I am so excited about this. I've actually started watching WandaVision now. It is so good. Like, literally, before we started talking, I started like the first episode and I was like, this is amazing. So, like, after we're done, I'm literally going to binge watch the rest. So,
you have to. He told me about the Marvel one, and I was trying not so subtly going, I want in on that one. Because if it's the movies, the comics, I dip in and out of the comics, so I'm not very well versed in that, but give me the movies. I mean, I've got a bloody Mjolnir behind me. I'm all over the MCU. Oh, that was my Christmas present for my folks this year. I don't know, the best present ever. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm eyeing that up behind you, and I was also eyeing up your Super Mario block.
Oh, yeah.
I was eyeing that up as well.
It lights up as well. It's great.
Mario Girl! I love that.
I'm quite the nerd, as you may. Well, I've got a Mario block tattoo as well.
Oh, so. That is awesome.
So.
Another half a Legend of Zelda tattoo up on his shoulder, so.
So. I have never played Zelda. I mean, I had it. I had a NES for a brief period, and I've never played any of the games. Right, we'll get video games in a sec. We'll finish off the Kurt Johansson stuff.
Kelly, it was nice talking to you. I'll see you later. No.
I don't know why. Hang on. Curry Hans and stuff. You're also doing D&Dub, which is your Dungeons and Dragons, easy for me to say, pod with yourself, Kurt, and I wrote down Ian Skinner.
Yeah,
that's right.
That is correct.
I don't think he would forgive me if I didn't mention that he was part of it as well.
He would not forgive you. He would hold that as a grudge, and he would proclaim, how dare you. And I'm sure he would get in a Borat quote in there somewhere as well.
I'll probably give me a row in our first episode because I said my wife without putting it in a Borat tone. it's very with the memes. I just downloaded TikTok like a month ago, and I'm still very confused about things. So
I have TikTok. I can't understand it, but I will go and watch on YouTube like the TikTok compilation videos just because I think they're hilarious. But you'll never catch me like using TikTok. Like I don't even have a Snapchat anymore because I don't know how to work it. I only literally got a Snapchat so that I could do the filters. So.
Oh, I didn't understand Snapchat. I kept re-downloading it, and my wife was like, "Oh, I'll send you Snapchats." Not that way. I'll send you Snapchats. I'm like, why? Just text me it.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm like. I'm like, why couldn't you just like text me or WhatsApp me? You know,
we've both got iPhones. It's free. Just
exactly.
But no, TikTok. It really is just because we'd spend the evening. I'd play obviously a grown-up game like Lego, and she would sit in the corner and just flick through a million more videos. So I had to see what this was about. And I mean, I'm just there for the dog videos, really. There's lots of dog videos, so the best way. Right, so video games then. We may as well do video games because we're dancing around that subject. And if you want to know about more about, anyone listening want to know about more about, God, there's words everywhere. D and Dub, listen to our Untitled podcast with Kurt Johansson. He'll explain it all, and it saves me looking confused twice in a podcast because I don't know anything about Dungeons and Dragons either.
I'll give a quick synopsis. It's fine. It's literally myself, Kurt, and Ian Skinner, and we are chatting all things Dungeons and Dragons because my other half, he plays Dungeons and Dragons. He was in it first. And they were a player down back in November because I've only been playing from November. And he kept asking me, like, please, 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 so we can actually get a game this week. Because otherwise, if they didn't have enough players, wouldn't have been able to do it. So I was like, okay. And I have been hooked ever since. I think it is the best thing ever. I am getting so invested in it already. And then Kurt found out that I played. And then Kurt, at this point, had already interviewed Ian. And then it was like the three of us all found out that we played Dungeons and Dragons. We're like, this is great. And I knew Kurt had been wanting to do the podcast for a while, Dungeons and Dub. And yeah, so that came about because we all like Dungeons and Dragons. This will be a fun podcast with the three of us. Let's go. And that's the quick synopsis.
Cool. I find that when I'm speaking to everyone that I've spoken to so far, two things always seems to crop up, which I really should do some research on because I know nothing about either, is anime and Dungeons and Dragons.
That I love anime as well, if that helps.
yeah, I've said before, I watched One Punch Man, I watched three episodes, I got the gist of it, I thought, well, this is the whole show now, I don't need to see the rest of it. I got it. but yeah, I don't know why. You think it would, because I'm all into that kind of, like, cartoons and all that kind of stuff, but no, I haven't found the one for me. I think that's probably the best way to put it, because I know that it's all different. It's a very wide,
yeah,
strange world, anime, it's much like wrestling.
Yeah, there's so many different genres of anime. Like, we'll do a series with you, Billy, right? And we'll call it, like, instead of Say Yes to the Dress, it'll be like Say Yes to the Anime. Say Aye to the Anime. There we go.
Anime. Okay. Yeah. You know what, if Kurt's wanting to add anything else to his slate at the moment, I'll easily watch some anime and report back going, I didn't understand a thing that happened in this. That's a great idea. I'm writing that down, actually. Kurt, if you're watching, there's an idea for you. Right. So, yeah, you do Pixel Bitches with your wrestler, Mad Jayla Dark. You also do Twitch Beach with Hearty Bro over on the Twitch. Aptly named Twitch. What made you decide to start doing the Twitch stuff?
So I had been wanting to do not just Twitch, like gaming content in general on YouTube and whatnot for a very long time, and it was just, to be perfectly honest, this is right around about the time that my bookings started to pick up a lot, so I was practically wrestling every weekend, which is amazing. But in between that and my real life job, you know, like my shoot job, and then the gym and training and all sorts, like just life got in the way. So I never really got a chance to sit down and film content. And then, of course, the world ended. So I had nothing better to do. No, honestly, I wanted to keep myself busy and motivated and keep the creativeness like flowing. So I thought, I love video games. Now's the perfect time to actually start up my video game content. And because I don't know how many times I'll work in like video game references, or I'll like be doing an interview like this and I'll talk about video games. And I was like, why don't I actually do some video game content? And the first ever stream that I did, it was like a 19-hour gameplay of Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time, all because Hearty Bro was determined that we were going to sit and do it in the one go. And you can actually see from that stream, like if you sat and you watched it consistently, you can see me like this on the couch, like falling asleep, like trying to keep myself like motivated. And I'm like, I can do it, I can do it. but unfortunately we couldn't. We tapped out about like 3 o'clock in the afternoon the next day.
I did catch up some of it because I tried Twitch for a little bit. Unfortunately, I made all these great Scottish wrestling characters because that's just what I did during the first lockdown. And then half of them got cancelled. So I was like, nah, this isn't fun anymore because all the ones that took so long to make, can't use them. And so, I made yourself, of course, which took ages. I don't think anyone will know how long it took because all your promo pictures, and this isn't, it's not slate at all, you're always smiling. And it's the most difficult thing to do a face thing on WWE 2K20. Anything's difficult on 2K20. But trying to get a face mapping over if someone's smiling, it's just so difficult. It took me ages to... I had to watch your video with when you did the posters for outside Jayla Dark's window.
Oh, yeah.
I had to watch that so many times just to get a screen grab. So if you noticed at some point that your views on that video went through the roof, it was me trying to get a screen grab of you looking at the screen without smiling.
That explains so much. That explains why that skyrocketed.
Oh, it just took so long. And then your hair was over. I was like, right, this is as good as it's going. That's it. I'm done. That's it. Done. Finished. But I think it's one of the better ones that I made of all of them.
It's amazing. Like, any time that you were tagging me and saying that you were on Twitch playing with my character, I was like, I am giving that a plug, I'm giving that a retweet, I know how much effort this takes to make the character, I will plug this for you.
I will never, anyone listening, anyone watching that wants Emily on their show, regardless of what it's about, she is going to plug it everywhere. So it is,
yes,
brilliant. And the amount of times where I put up a tweet going, oh, still time to get questions, and then I'll get a notification on Facebook, Instagram, Instagram again, because you use my personal account as well as my actual SWN account. And it was just like, right, okay, all bases covered. I haven't do anything. It's great. We've got a guest. A guest has arrived for those watching the video feed. If you want to introduce one of your crack lawyers, if I remember rightly.
He's one of my top lawyers. He's taking a break right now. He loves the camera. He's done this a few times whenever I've had a camera on. Like, see, even when I would like film promos, or like, see, when I was filming Ask If I Speech and that, he would just so happen to pop into the camera and then he'd redo it again. I think he loves the attention. He's my social cat out of the two of them. So yeah. Okay, are you saying hello? No.
Sorry, well, my dog has probably went out. It's went off in a huff. It's probably sleeping on our bed just now. My bed with my wife. Our bed. She's probably huffing in there because, yeah, she likes the attention, but I think she finds it weird when she comes into this room and I'm speaking to myself. And she's like, that's a bit weird. They want any part of that, and just leaves the room. She's a bit of an odd duck. Right. So, video games. Twitch, when did you first fall in love with video games? What was your first console?
My first console, wow. It was either the Super Nintendo or the NES. I remember it being a Nintendo console anyway. And I remember like so many hours being put into like Diddy Kong Country. And that, but the one that I have the most memories on in particular is the PlayStation 1, because that was when I really got into gaming. Because you know what it's like when you're a kid before, it'd be like you put on like Mortal Kombat or something, so you bash the buttons, you wouldn't really know what you're doing, so you bash the buttons. That was me. and then it was my brother that really got into mini gaming, so he and I would sit and play Super Mario World, Diddy Kong Country, Mario Kart, the really old Legend of Zelda games, so A Link to the Past. We also played, obviously, Ocarina of Time on the N64, Mario 64, This is just going to be like a whole bit of me talking about like all the consoles only, because I still own the consoles from when I was a kid. Like, I literally have my Pikachu Nintendo 64 over there looking at me. And but yeah, distinctly it was the PlayStation 1 I always remember playing. And what are you doing? What are you, he's being a weirdo, he's like trying to attack the wire. and yeah, so PlayStation 1, I always remember playing with my brother. So like Crash Bandicoot, Spyro the Dragon, and then Final Fantasy 7's one of my all-time favourite games, so I always remember playing that with him. Are you intrigued by this? No? No, he's not interested. So yeah, first ever console, it is between the NES and the Super Nintendo.
I think mine was the Sega.
Really?
Mega Drive. Yeah.
Oh, we have one of those.
My dad used to work at the hospital here in Elgin, and of course stuff would get donated, and if it was getting chucked, he was like, no, I'll be taking that home. So I think we had an Atari at one point, an Atari, we had the Genesis, we had a Mega Drive, NES, SNES, but yeah, PS1 is my I would consider my first proper console.
Yeah, I'm the exact same. Like I said, that's where I really got into my gaming. Like, that's when I became like a big Final Fantasy fan, from playing Final Fantasy VII, and my love kind of I just carried on from there.
I think my brain tells me it was Crash Bandicoot was what I loved, but it's Spyro, because I played Crash when the remaster came out, and I could not do anything in it. I was awful, but give me Spyro when that came out, I was all over it. Back on the remaster. 100%.
Like, I got the Spyro Reignited trilogy, and I completed the first one as soon as I got the game. I think I got that like 2 years ago. And then a year ago, I completed Spyro 2 in the Reignited trilogy. And then literally like about a month ago or so, I completed Spyro 3 on the Reignited trilogy. And that one reminded me how much I loved the original Spyro 3. Even though when you would save the dragon eggs, I thought that game was amazing. Especially because you would do like the, you know how the skateboarding mini game. I loved that. I thought that was awesome.
I think I'm one trophy away from completing the second one. It's a double dragon thing that just I got so frustrated that I just gave up and went. I obviously the one rule is I don't swear on this podcast, but there was a lot of words that I cannot use on this podcast during it after about an hour of doing it. Hated it. But no, I was one of the first games I got when I got my PS3. I downloaded the PS1 versions and all that. That and Toy Story 2.
I love that.
Highly underrated game.
It's so.
Which I think if I played it now, I don't know what it is. I don't know if I'm getting older, but I'm just so bad at games that I was so good at when I was younger. And vice versa, I was awful at Streets of Rage, and then I got it on the PS3 and completed it within half an hour. And I was like, how did this take so long in the Sega?
Streets of Rage is so good. Like, I literally have the soundtrack to it on my iPhone and my iTunes, like, Streets of Rage.
But I love those games. The Sega Mega Drive collection on the PS3, that got a lot of play in my house when I had it. I keep looking to get it on the PS4, but it's like, should I? Eventually, I will eventually. But I'm all in on Lego games, because it's something my wife will play, and therefore I can play at the same time. And it just, it's a nice bonding experience, because our gaming prowess was Tetris before. And the game I got her for Christmas, because it was nostalgic for her, was the Westlife trivia game. Fanorama, that's what it was called. It's the only game she completed beforehand, before meeting me, and now she's completed like, I don't know, 5 or 6 Lego games. So it's just that's her gaming journey. But yeah, Westlife Fanorama. Didn't know it'd be made. there's a Friends one apparently as well. I keep seeing it for the PS2 and looking at it going, go on eBay, Friends, PS2, and you'll find it.
All right. After this interview, I'm so doing that. Like, I'm in a little peek into the household, the Hayden household. I'm in Hearty Bros Bad Books right now, because I've practically got everything to do with Friends. So I've got my the infamous my name is Regina Phalange coffee mug. I got that from a friend for Christmas. I also got a big Central Perk mug, like the big ridiculous size mugs. And he got me for my Christmas a friend's house coat. And he also got me for my birthday friend's pajamas. But I kept saying to him, oh, and he also got me a friend's phone cover. And but I kept saying to him, can we please get the duvet set? Can we please get the duvet set? And then when we were up in Asda the other day, I seen they've actually got a friend's dinner set, like plates and stuff. And he was like, we are not getting that. And then he was like, we are not getting a friend's duvet set. And then his mum actually got me for Christmas the friend's duvet set. So she says, like, oh, make sure he sees that. And I was like, ah, well. So I was like, look what your mum got me. Look what's going on in the bed tonight. And he was raging. He says it's comfy, but I hate it.
So, see, I'm the complete opposite. I'm super encourageable with that kind of stuff because my wife loves, well, I'll call her Kelly because I keep saying my wife. I'm going to end up doing a Borat impression and nobody wants that. But her big thing is Nightmare Before Christmas and Harry Potter. Yeah. Two favourite things. So my tradition somehow has become, if she gets a new job or she has good news that particular day, I buy her a new Harry Potter book. So she currently has 5 different kinds of copies of the Philosopher's Stone. So different covers, the Gryffindor edition, Hufflepuff, the Scottish one, hardback, all that kind of stuff. And I was so happy the day. I don't know if you've ever seen the set, but the box has Hogwarts on the back of it. It's like purple and it's got Hogwarts. Found it on a buy swap on Facebook, £15. And I was like, someone's selling that super cheap. I'm going to totally rip them off and go get it. So yeah, I'm super encourageable. She's went, oh, the first thing I ever bought her, like collection wise, is when I noticed she had like a couple Westlife DVDs missing. So I spent weeks on eBay just going, oh, I found this, it was £2, here you go. And I was, yeah, I'm quite a hoarder for that kind of stuff. I like to see a collection complete.
I share those sentiments, but can I just say that is like the sweetest thing I've ever heard. You're such a good husband.
I'm all right. But no, if she's got a collection of like makeup, I'm very scared about buying makeup. But I saw at Revolution, we're doing Nightmare Before Christmas stuff.
Yes.
I was like, right. I had to look at her makeup kit for ages, looking at the screen on my phone going, that looks about the right colour. I'll go for that. So, yeah, for as much as I annoy her with other things, I'm all right at the gift-giving bit. I'll buy her happiness if I have to. That's pretty much the be-all and end-all of that story.
I love the fact you went the extra mile, though, and you actually looked through her makeup and going like, oh, that woman, she would actually wear, that's nice. I love that. That's going the extra mile. You get bonus points for that, I'm sure.
Well, there was ones that I liked to look at. She likes Oogie Boogie, and I thought, that's a really nice one. And I looked at the colour and went, nah, she wouldn't wear it. She wouldn't wear it at all. And, yeah, it was, yeah, I'm not bad. Anyway, right, okay, so video games, I think we've crossed that off. We'll go back to wrestling in a second because that can be towards the end. Where else have I got on this list here? What's your favourite dinosaur?
Oh, that's easy. Triceratops.
See, it's a popular one. It's a popular one.
It's because of Power Rangers. I love Billy in Power Rangers.
Yes! Yes, Blue Power Ranger. Awesome. He wasn't my favourite, but he was one of the coolest ones because, of course, he's called Billy, so became the coolest one. are you just Mighty Morphin, or did you move any further past
Mighty Thanks Morphin? To my brother, because again, it was my brother that got me into Power Rangers, so I watched a lot of Power Rangers. Did you watch a lot of Power Rangers too? Is this where you're coming in the shot? So yeah, I watched all the way up to Overdrive, I believe it was. He's going to try and crawl my lap, I'm sorry. I watched all the way up to Overdrive, I believe it's called. No, wait, I tell a lie. Mystic Force. I wasn't a big fan of Mystic Force, and I stopped watching since. I'll kind of watch, like, see, you know how they do like crossovers or like specials. I watched those. So like I watched like the Forever Red one. I watched that and it was all the Red Rangers. That was awesome. I've kind of went the opposite now, where I watch a load. I was going to say a naughty word there. I'm sorry. I watch a load of Super Sentai, like the. So I watch a lot of Super Sentai thanks to my brother, and I'm right into Kamen Rider just now. I think Kamen Rider's amazing.
Yes, it got a US remake, Mask Rider.
Yeah, Mask Rider. See, anytime I bring up Mask Rider, no one knows what I'm talking about.
I thought it was a Mandela effect thing. Like, did it actually happen? Because I remember it.
So it was like, around about that time, it was like Mighty Morphin, Mask Rider, VR, and Beetleborgs. And it's like, anytime I bring up like any of those names, I'll get like Mask Rider, people are like, what? Or like Beetleborgs, a couple of people will be like, yeah, but most of them will be like, what?
Finally.
I'm like, how do you not know who Mask Rider is?
I'm so glad there's someone who knows who Mask Rider is. But yeah, I used to have the original figure of the actual Mask Rider, green and black and all that. And he was my Rey Mysterio figure for a very long time. When I had wrestling figures as well, and I had the blue one with his motorbike, the talking motorbike.
I love that.
So yeah, Mask Rider. I'm so happy someone else has heard of it. I feel like I've been making it up for years. Because you Google it and it just comes up with Kamen Rider, and it says it was made in Japan or whatever. I'm like, yeah. Oh, there was definitely a US remake.
It was on Fox Kids. I distinctly remember this. That was how I seen it. It was Fox Kids. And then I was talking to Hearty Bro about that, and I was like, did you ever watch Mask Rider? He was like, what's that? And I was affronted, Billy. Like, I was like, how has no one heard of Mask Rider?
Oh, it's the best day ever, right? Okay, let's patch the rest of the interview and go watch Mask Rider. Right, I don't know where to go with that because that's made me so happy. Speaking of happy, I've got a note here. I've got a note saying, ADM's best pal. Last thing on the Power Ranger stuff, you will want to watch the video with Alistair Adams because he has two replica Red Ranger helmets.
No way!
And he showed me them on the Zoom call and they look amazing. It's one's a Wild Force one, I think. So, yeah, Alistair Adams, if you're looking for a new pal, There's the way to go.
Look at my face, like, as soon as you said replica, I'm like, I was
amazed and annoyed at the same time, because I thought the coolest thing in the video was going to be the hammer behind me, but no, then he showed me those, and I was like, ah, oh, that could go in the bin now, this looks just rubbish in comparison. Oh, it was just amazing. Yeah, so I'm just totally off my start now that someone else knows Mask Rider. Right, so in our interview with Alexander Darwin McCallum, which hasn't been released as yet, I got the gist from his words about you is he finds you to be the happiest person in the world, which annoys him greatly. So it's a compliment. Anyway.
We balance each other out. He is the yin to my yang. And as much as he says he is not my best friend, deep down, he knows he's my best friend. And we are the Clyde River Beaches. So don't let him kid you. He says it annoys him, but he means it with love. That's his way of saying it.
So his pretty much his words were, yeah, he found you annoyingly happy. So what was it like being ADM for the first time? Do you have any memories of that wonderful day?
Oh, let me just reminisce. the first time I ever met ADM, I believe it was when they were doing Solar was doing the Best Kept Secret shows, and it was that was kind of a way to show, because it was like kind of a closed doors, so it would be promoters and other wrestlers and trainers could watch and see how you were as a wrestler. And that was how I actually met ADM, because he was on that show. I didn't really speak to him at first, to be honest with you. I thought he was very intimidating, so I didn't know what to say. But now I know that he does that so that he keeps his guard up. But when you get that guard down, he's a teddy bear. Like, I love him to bits. he tries to hit me with sarcasm and be cheeky whenever he sees me. But I know it's because he loves me and he misses me, and he wants to see me do well, just like I want to see him do well. And we will be a tag team someday on a show. You can bank on that. I promise us.
I will hold you to it. Then, therefore, I can go into our fan questions now. So, Alan, who of course is, I think he is one of your lieutenants of Emily's army. He asked two questions, which you kind of answered the first one, but he said, "Why does ADM love you so much?"
Yep, he loves me so much because I'm so happy and I balance him out.
I might just clip that and just put it out now, just to get the ball rolling for the episode coming out next month. And now that you've started snapping limbs off beaches, who would you want in an Iron Man match, Iron Woman match?
Oh, that's a good question. So there are two names that spring to mind. In fact, three. One is my little wrestle daughter, Chantal Jordan. I would love to do an Ironman match with her. She is so talented. Like, see, for someone so young, like, it scares me to think how talented she's going to be when she's my age. I'm an old lady, so. So Chantal Jordan, Giselle Shaw, because she is just a top-notch performer. And of course, I'm going to say Kaylee Ray. That would be amazing.
Just to go off your comment about Chantel being your wrestle daughter, does that mean Jayla is her wrestle grandma?
Yeah, but we try not to use the word grandma around Jayla.
That's absolutely fair.
That's how you get battered off of Jayla, and I don't want to go through that street fight again, you know.
I'm feeling safe making that comment because I'm up in the sticks here in the northeast, so I feel safe. But if suddenly her internet dies watching this episode and it comes back on at this point, I will not be disappointed. So Big Benny, he asked, which is better, Gunship or Big Benny's driving skills?
Well, I'm going to have to go with Benny's driving skills. No, I've already told the story about his driving skills. You all know where I stand for that. As much as I thought it was hilarious, he thought it was terrifying. But the whole Gunship thing comes about because that was one of the first things me and Benny bonded over, the band Gunship. And all me and him ever doing, we're in the car together, you know, before we die. we always listen to a lot of Gunship. So they're one of my top bands.
Okay, Kurt, you've pretty much answered these questions as well, so you don't have to go into detail, but he's put, Kurt Johansson's put, why am I her bestie?
Because we have amazing chemistry and he is one of the best people I know.
And the other one is, let's talk about the two projects coming up, which we've pretty much covered, Dean Dub and WrestlePals, so we'll move on to Ella J. Friend of the show, friend of yours as well, of course, of a Wrestling Gal podcast, a fantastic podcast that everyone should be checking out. She's asked, what's the most fun to play, Wrestlebeech, Advicebeech, Tweetchbeech, or Podcastbeech?
See, that's tricky. Like, I can't narrow it down because they're all fun in so many different ways. Like, Wrestlebeech, it's like what you touched on before. It's like I get to put on, like, this bad beach persona, and I'm snapping limbs and whatnot, as my lieutenant put it. So it's fun that way because I'm getting to show people the new side to my wrestling ability. Twitch Beach is fun, obviously, because I love video games and I get to showcase what games I like. And one of my favourite moments, in fact, playing online was a lot of Emily's Army hadn't heard of Tower 3, which is one of my all-time favourite games, and the fact that I got to play it and show them it, and showcase this, in my opinion, one of the most underrated games ever, that was awesome. Advicebeech was all sorts of hilarity, and Podcastbeech, I'm starting to find my footing with it, I've still got a lot of learning and growing to do in that aspect, but I'm enjoying it so far because, if you couldn't guess, I like to talk with all my other personas, you know, so why not podcast speech? So that's a hard decision. So they're all fun in different ways.
Absolutely. I mean, I don't know. Well, I think, again, I've said it before in podcasts, I'm a very shy person in real life. So if you see me at a show, I look like the most miserable person on the planet. It's just my face. But doing this, it means I get to interact with people. I get this is actually been my saving grace through this whole lockdown thing. I didn't think I'd miss social interaction because I'm quite a home person, but this is like my 2 hours a week, depending on how many interviews I have, of actual human contact without having to be like physically with people. It's great. But yeah, podcasting, I have said that any idiot can make a podcast, but it's a lot of fun. So I'm glad you're enjoying the journey so far, and I'm looking forward to, I'm definitely going to be listening to Wrestle Pals because I'll be listening to that Marvel episode going, speak about this, speak about that, because I'll love it. Right, and she's also asked, because I asked, what's your favourite dinosaur, what's your favourite mammal?
Otter.
Oh, nice choice. I just remember a videotape, Tarka the otter. It was just an otter going through its day. It was like an Attenborough thing, but not Attenborough. It was just an otter. It's lovely.
I love otters so much. It's they're actually my favorite animal in general, and because I think the sweetest thing ever, facts that I've learned about them are they hold hands like this, like when they're swimming, when they sleep, so they don't float away from each other. And their babies, they wrap in seaweed on their stomachs as well, to keep them floating, which I think is adorable. And I remember I went to the Edinburgh Zoo a couple of years ago, and they had like the little otter habitat, and my heart melted when I saw this little otter having the time of his life with a pebble, and he's sitting like playing with us, like chucking it in the air and catching it, and that it was adorable. I love otters, honestly. I could do a podcast about them.
I don't know, once you start Wrestle Pals and D&W, will be the Ottercast will be next.
Ottercast, there we go.
But no, things like that, when you're speaking about that, that's why I love my dog is the most. You may have seen pictures of her, because if anyone asks for a picture of a pet to cheer them up, there's a good chance I'm going to send them a picture of my dog, because she's the most cutest thing in the world, and I'm just saying that because it's my dog. But yeah, she'll spend an evening just lying on her back pawing at something, no idea what she's pawing at, nothing, just air. And it's like, if she's been an absolute, how to say it without swearing, tool the whole day, and she just sits through that and goes, "Ah, you're all right, you're not bad. You can stay in the house."
Especially during lockdown, I feel like the cats have provided me with so much entertainment. So I really want a dog, but Hartybro won't let me get one right now. Like you said, because we stay in a flat. He said when we get a place that's got like a front door and a back door, we can get a dog. And I was like, that's fair. Yeah, but until then, I hold on hope that I will get a dog.
Oh, they're the best, even if they are waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning to conveniently jump under the bed. Right, so I've got Lauren, because I have to do by searching. I went to Instagram, you shared on Instagram. Lauren's asked, how long were you doing your training before you got in the ring?
How long did I do training before I got in the ring? Wow. If we're talking in terms of before I debuted, I trained for 2 years before I debuted. That is longer than the average person that's graduated from my school. It's like, the very least, you hear them 6 months to a year. But for me, it was 2 years, and that comes because of my shyness and my anxiety. I was always like so anxious to go to Barhead and show what I could do. And that really, it was my anxiety, it was the only thing that held me back. So yeah, it took me 2 years of training before I eventually got in the ring. Don't let your anxiety control you that much, folks, honestly, because getting in the ring was the best thing I ever did.
And she also asked, do you have to be a certain age to start training?
Depending on the school that you go to, because some schools will take like ages 12 and up, some schools will take 16 and over. So the best advice that I can give, rather than age-wise, is just do your research and find not necessarily the school that's closest to you, just find the best school. If you want it badly enough, like you'll travel to that school. That was always what I was told. So age, I wouldn't really say is a factor, because I mean I started when I was 17 going on 18, and age is not a factor. Do your research on the school and make sure it is a high standard school. I would say just not just in terms of making sure you get the best training, but for your safety as well.
Okay. Shannon has asked, just quite bluntly, biscuit or cake?
See, I'm torn between that because... because I'm like, I love cookies, so I'm like, biscuit. But then I'm like, you've seen like all the mad cakes and stuff that I put online that I made. Like, I literally made the other day a cheesecake for me and Hearty Bro for Valentine's Day.
I love cheesecake.
And I'll put a photo of that up later, in fact, so you can see. But this is like Sophie's Choice.
you can cause even more mass hysteria by just going Jaffa cake, it's both.
Ah! I love Jaffa cakes as well. Can I narrow it down? I like cookies and I love chocolate cake and cheesecake.
I was going to say any particular favourite of either, but you pretty much answered that as well. I don't know what it's about. Chocolate cake, I'm really hit or miss for. Cheesecake, I love. Give me a cheesecake. Oh. I'm all over it. But my dad, he says he started making chocolate cake. But the texture and the consistency is what he's made is a humongous brownie. Which I loved even more because I'm very hit or miss with chocolate cake, love brownies. And he's like, well, I've made chocolate cake. I'm like, you haven't. You've made a brownie. And I like it. So just, I don't want to tell him that he's not making cake because then he'll stop making it. And I don't want that to happen either. But yeah, he's just making giant brownies and they're just incredible. Stone Malone is asked, as we're on food, Stone Malone's asked, favourite McFlurry?
He knows the answer to this, which is a Dairy Milk McFlurry. And a side note with a little story to that, me and Stone Malone, we thought it was a rib when it got put online that they were doing away with the Dairy Milk McFlurries. We're like, there is no chance. And then when we actually found out that that was real from McDonald's, we were heartbroken. We're like, how are we supposed to replace a Dairy Milk McFlurry? I'm looking at like the Smarties one and I'm like, this isn't the same. So it's Dairy Milk McFlurry.
Smarties my pick.
I like the Smarty one, but for me it's because like I was just bitter about them getting rid of the Dairy Milk one, so I was just like, you're not the same.
We've got Jason Hyde, who you might know, I'm not sure though. He's put, ask her to be on my podcast or I'm sending the pigeon.
Who?
I don't know. I think I did his podcast, maybe. I'm not sure.
That sounds like some sort of a randomer.
We'll just ignore it. And last question, a bit more of a, I don't know, could be a serious one, I don't know. Caledonian Wrestling Federation asked, how would you feel about a wrestling company that didn't or wouldn't book female talents? So we've ground to halt the fun with that question.
So how would I feel about a wrestling company that doesn't book females?
I think so. Or maybe just refuses to book females.
Or refuses? Honestly, I feel, obviously I'm not happy about it as a female, but personally I think, as you've seen, wrestling evolves, look, we went from the golden era to the attitude era, and then look how it's elevated now, and with that, women's wrestling has also elevated, like to the point where I wouldn't even say women's wrestling anymore, I would just say wrestling. Because the names that I can fling out right now, Kaylee, Casey, Viper, Tony Storm, etc. These are all names that are on par with the men. Like, they are just as good as the men. Of course, like Sasha Banks, Bayley, the Four Horsewomen, you know, like Charlotte's one of the best athletes in my eyes. And for a company not to book women, I feel like they're not moving with the times because wrestling's evolving. And women's wrestling is a big freaking deal right now. I tried so hard not to swear.
I respect that, yeah.
it's a big deal. Like, look at all the amazing stuff that they're doing now. And in particular, like, Becky Lynch has really broken a lot of glass ceilings. Lately, it was with the whole being at the top of the game and leaving to have a baby, which I think is amazing because it showed that you can have a career and be a mum at the same time. I feel like if you do not have women on your shows, if you are not booking women wrestlers, I hate using that term, but it's the only way I can describe it right now, then you're not moving with the times and you're not evolving. And a lot of people, they don't want to just see women just because it's women. They actually want to see what we can do now because it's elevated so much. So it's sad.
I mean, my thought of it is, you can have a show without any women on it. You can have a show without any men on it. Fine.
Yeah.
But if you're going out your way to go, I'm not booking them because of them being female, that's a different matter. Because I know there's some places that it's just not, they use their core group and they don't have any women in that group. So why would they pay that expense to get people down the road to come up or the road to come down if they've got a team already? But I'm of the opinion, if you're going out your way to not book someone because they're female, then that's stupid.
Oh no, that is a no-no. Like, I don't mind the fact that there's still some companies that are just like all men companies or, like you say, all women's companies. That's fine. Teach their own and whatnot. But like you say, if you're just going out your way to be like, women's wrestling is still at this level when it's actually up at this level now, you know? And you're just being, to put it bluntly, you're being sexist, then yeah, I don't agree with that.
Excellent. Right, let's kick up the fun again. So we got place you've been, I've got noted, outside of not in England, of course, we had Full Tilt, UCW. We've also had Reckless, Fair City, Caithness, which must have been a journey and a half, where you're from. Respect, of course, which would you say that would probably one of your home companies now?
Yeah, I would say that is one of my home companies now, because I'm there all the time, but obviously lockdown's like put a damper on that. But when I could, I would be there, and I would be harassing Bobby.
Along with that, Discovery Wrestling, you made a couple appearances at. But the new company in town, we'll be hopefully speaking to Logan Storm in the next couple of weeks, is Pro 2.
Yeah.
So what were your thoughts on Pro 2, or what thoughts of the companies you've worked with so far? Any highlights or anything that you want to accomplish in any particular companies in Scotland?
Well, with Pro 2, I think it's really awesome the amount of talent that they're getting in, and they're distinctly making it a point to have a women's division. From the Logan was showing me, like, he's put it up on the Pro 2 Facebook page as well, but he was showing me photos of the women's title belt, which looks beautiful. And I'm really happy to see that he really wants a women's division. Like, he's really going out his way to have one, and he signed like so many amazing different talents. He signed Angel Hayes, Rosie Knight, myself, up and comers like Ruby Roberts, and obviously I can't forget Ashley Vega as well, like another top talent. A lot of great names are coming out of this, but I could rattle on and on about the women's division. But he's got a lot of really good ideas in the works, and so I'm very excited to get in about that. And in terms of highlights for other companies, I would probably say, of course, because Respect's one of my home companies, it's got a soft spot in my heart. Like, that's where I learned to, in recent times, that's where I was going and practicing my new moveset and whatnot under the watchful eye of Bobby Roberts and DCT. And thanks to them, I've been able to showcase on the WWE Network my new wrestling style, which I'm so happy that people seem to be enjoying. Like, I've been getting a lot of praise about that recently. So respect is a highlight for me in terms of helping me grow as a wrestler. And of course, shout out to W3L and UCW because they've decided to make Mayhem with two belts. And I'm always grateful for that. In terms of any aspirations that I've got with any other companies, I guess for Pro Tour, I would love to be able to say that I'm Emily Three Belts. That'd be awesome. So that's a goal of mine, to really cement myself in their women's division and hopefully be an Emily Three Belts, maybe an Emily Four Belts at some point down the line. And how can I not mention Fierce Females? Like, an aspiration for mine is like to not be fired and actually get to compete, you know? Like, who knows?
Maybe what I mean, that could be Emily Five Belts by that point, if you get that title as well. But oh, the Pro 2 Championship, I love their championships tonight designs. I was on the fence about them announcing talent because I'm like, but there's no shows. How can you announce them on? But the more I've thought about it, it's like giving you a preview. This is who we've agreed to have. So I got it. But initially, I was just like, why are you announcing so many people? There's no shows. Anyway, but I got there eventually. I was speaking to Logan about it, I'm sure, and he'll very much fill me in and on what he's got planned. But I love the belt because it looks... I love any belts that's got a different coloured strap other than black, for one. The Fair City belts are all different coloured and they're just... Yeah. I love them like that. But it's also got the oval design. So it's very... reminiscent of the WWF women's title as well.
That's why I love that. Like, just even you're talking about like different straps, like that's why I loved the Intercontinental Championship for so long, because it was the white strap. I thought that was amazing because it looked like such a different title from the rest because of it. So yeah, when Logan showed me that it had the red strap and that, I was like, this is awesome. Oh my god, like you say, it's not a black strap.
But yeah, black strap's great. I mean, my favourite belt is the one I've got behind me, which is the European, which you can't see, which is the European belt title, and it's got the black strap. But it's got green behind it, which is especially why I like it even more. But yeah, belts, sometimes it could be a bit weird. It's like WWE ones right now are a bit on the nose. If it's SmackDown, it's blue. If it's Raw, it's red. I'm like, ah, okay, cool. But yeah, belts with not black straps, that's the way to go in the future. Yes, you mentioned that you're on the WWE Network, which follows on perfectly, because I think this is one of my last notes that I have written down. What does your dad think when he started? He made you, but he introduced you to WWF and WWE, and now you're on their network. How mental is that?
Mental, very mental. It is surreal. So I'll actually tell you a story. So obviously I told my dad and my family and that I was going to be on the WWE Network, and they were excited. So my dad's like, oh, give me your WWE login so I can watch you. I was like, no problem. So he watched the match, the first match that I'd done, and literally I think 10 minutes after I sent him the login details, I got a phone call, and he's on the phone, and the first thing he said was, wow. That was the first thing he said. He went, wow. And he was like, I am so proud of you. To think when you first started wrestling, and I thought because of how shy you are, like, it wasn't really going to go anywhere. Look, my dad's brutally honest, like, and he's like, I can say it to you right now, like, you know what, I'll just tell you how it is. I'm always overly critical when it comes to your matches. He'll just tell me how it is and that. And he was like, but honestly, wow, I am so proud of you, and I get to say that my baby daughter has wrestled on the WWE Network. So the two of us were crying on the phone together, and so it was when he said that he was proud, like that was amazing. Like it really warms my heart, like thinking about that moment right now. Like I got to share that special moment with him on the phone. The man that got me into wrestling gets to see me on the WWE Network. So it's he always says he's a dad, he always says that he's proud of me and that, but that's like one of those moments where you know that he was seriously proud, and the fact that I've got him that proud of me, it means the world. Like, I'm a daddy's girl, so it means the world to me, and I'll never forget that phone call.
So yeah, you've gone from, in 6 years, you've went from wrestling in front of your dad, your friends and family, other people's friends and family, to wrestling technically in front of nobody, but potentially with 1.2 million subscribers now of the WWE Network, something like that. It's about a million anyway. Potentially being seen by over a million people in 6 years.
Wow. So when you say it like that, it just, yeah. Wow, it really hits you. Like, you know what? I didn't actually register until, when my dad asked me for the login details. It didn't really, like, sink home that I was on the WWE Network. That was the moment where I was like, oh my God, I'm on the WWE Network. And when you're putting it like that now, I'm like, getting that, oh, wow, like, that's crazy to think. You forget how far you actually come, like when you think it day by day, you actually forget how far. That's a wow, 6 years, wow, oh wow.
and just to make it even more crazy for you, with the Peacock deal, potentially you'll be on the same network as The Office. So yeah, done all right in 6 years.
Not bad.
It'll do. It's a living. Okay, so before we wrap up, because I think we've you're now the second guest ever to tip 2 hours of an
wow,
interview.
Really?
Yeah, I think so. I think started. Yeah.
Lots of time.
So we'll do a couple or two more questions. We'll do the social medias, and then we can go and have a well-earned rest. You can finish WandaVision, because I need you to. Because if you've only seen the first one, oh my God, I'm up to the most recent episode, and it is just wild.
I'm so excited for this.
Oh, I mean, the only thing I don't like is the extended credit sequence. But other than that, love it. But yeah, I don't want to spoil anything. Just I need you to go watch it. So, right, before, when the shows come back, you said you want to wrestle Chantel again, but is there any, you mentioned who you want to wrestle in an Iron Woman match, but who is your dream opponent, past, present, whoever? Who's your dream opponent?
My dream opponent, one name sticks in my head right now, and that is Viper. I would love to wrestle Viper. I think me and her would kill it, honestly. She's so badass, I love her.
I think at this stage, she's the only regular wrestler in Scotland you haven't wrestled. I think you wrestled everyone else. Sammy and Carmel, Sarah, yeah. So, Viper, she's, or Piper Niven, I suppose. We've got to go by the...
Or Piper Niven, yeah.
Got to go by that name now. But, yeah, okay, cool. And, great. So, what's the end game then? What's the goal? Is it WWE? Is it just enjoying yourself? What's the 5-year plan for wrestling?
So, I'd be lying if I said, like, oh, I've got no interest in going to WWE. But honestly, in the time since I've actually started training, like, wrestling has evolved so much, and the world within wrestling, I didn't realise just how big it was. So of course there's WWE. I would love to go to WWE. I would love to do NXT UK. I would love to do AEW. I would love to do TNA. One of my dreams from the get-go has been to follow in the same footsteps as Marissa Maggi Ladark, Viper, Piper Niven, Kaylee Ray, Tony Storm, Isla Dawn, etc., and go over to Japan and wrestle. I would love to do that. That has been a dream of mine for so long. And I would love to be able to, like, if we did another interview in a couple of years' time, I would love to be able to say to you at this point, like, oh, I've been and I've got to experience that. Because from talking to Jayla and Aisha and the other girls about it, it sounds like an amazing experience. And I feel like that would help me hone my craft a little bit more as well, in terms of, because I want to better myself as a wrestler. So, yeah, my dream is Japan, but the end goal, I would say, is quite possibly one of the top companies like WWE, AEW, TNA, one of those, and make my dad proud, you know?
Oh, well, I can honestly say, just from last year alone, at least, you've definitely got the drive and passion for it, so there's nothing that's impossible, I don't think, if you set your mind to it. But yeah, before we go then, how can people find you? We've got an hour if you want to go through all your socials, because you're everywhere. But where can people find you?
It's so much easier than trying to remember all my namesakes. So on Twitter, you can find me at EmilyHayden_UK. On Instagram, it's just Emily Hayden. It's easy to find. You'll see my ugly mug pop up. and then on Instagram, it is _EmilyHayden_. And those are the only three social medias I have. So if you see any phonies out there, that's not me. Or maybe it is, and I'm just winding you up. On any plug Toasties Twitter as well. So it's at the Toasty, I believe it is. I need to check that, in fact, to say Toasty! Toasty! I think he's sleeping.
maybe he's popped out.
Ha-ha!
There we go.
Yeah, _Toasty. So you can follow him on there if you want some amazing banter.
Amazing. But yeah, thank you so much for... Like I said, the time has flown by. The only one that's beaten this now is the Scotty Swift episode, which is 2.5. And wow. I don't know how, because we'd already spoke for about 2 hours in the first. Yeah. We've done about 4 to 5 hours of chatting about nothing, it seemed. But we've covered so much. I'm sure if we started speaking more about the TV shows that we liked, we would probably be here for another good while. This is probably a very wrestling heavy episode, strangely enough. But I had Two Broke Girls written down, but we'll leave that to yourself in part three with Ella, if you do a part three with her. But yeah,
you can also do a part two, you know, so.
Well, we've got plenty of time.
Can I just say as well, when you said Scotty Swift, I just want to give him a special shout out. I love him so much because he knows I'm a big fan of Ghostbusters. So he'll always sit and message me of the different collection items and whatnot, and you'll be like, I seen this and I thought you would want it too, and it is great. Like, I'm getting stocked up in lots of Ghostbuster stuff I would have easily missed out on if it wasn't for him. Like, we sat and we spoke for a solid half an hour about Ghostbusters one day, and then another day it was like a solid half an hour about Exorcist. So he's a good man. Shout out Scotty Swift.
And if you got the time, go check out the episodes, because you can see his collection behind him, and it's like part of it. And he has an unbridled love for The Exorcist 2, the actual movie. I don't think he likes it. I think he just likes having a t-shirt of it. But yeah, definitely worth checking out. But since I spoke to him, and every time I see him now, it's Ghostbusters. I went into B&M just and randomly, and I saw Peter Venkman pop for a fiver, and I was like, I don't even like Ghostbusters that much, but I'm just getting drawn towards it. I must buy it just to impress Scotty Swift. But anyway, right, we've done the socials. That's supposed to be the show ender. But thank you very much for joining me on the SWN podcast. It has been an absolute delight. And I can see why ADM calls you one of the nicest people in wrestling. I don't know why it annoys him so much, but I can see why he says so.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me, honestly.